Okay, well, in keeping with our next speaker's decades-long resistance to the levelling of the world's linguistic diversity by the English language, he's going to be speaking in his native tongue, which is French. However, we will have an ongoing translation into English by a representative of the Zentropa community, Charles here, who's a Frenchman. In reality, of course, the speaker in question needs little introduction, being the founder member of the Research and Study Group for European Civilisation, known best by its French acronym of GRECE. He's the author of dozens of books and essays examining topics such as philosophy, political theory, and religion. He's also the editor of two French language intellectual journals, Nivolicole and Crisis. It's not an overstatement to say that the resonances and reverberations of this man's work have made themselves felt all over our continent, even if only faintly up to now in brainwashed Britannia. However, this may well be changing with the recent but ongoing publication of some of his works in English, a selection of which you can buy at the back of the room. It's not hyperbole to say the prime reason I'm here today, and by priority this conference is taking place, stems from the work of our next speaker, which I was exposed to many years ago through Michael Walker's excellent journal, Scorpion. Going back to that time, I never thought I'd actually hear the following words. I certainly never dreamt they'd be coming out of my mouth, but ably abetted by Charles, today in London, making his debut major public speaking appearance to an Anglophone audience, Monsieur Alain de Benoist.
Thanks, mate. Thanks, everybody, for coming. Let's move now to a very different topic. I'm going to speak about geopolitics, and especially geopolitics today, but I will do that in French because my English is not so good, and I thought that hearing successively two French people trying to speak English would be too much for you. So I will speak in French, but the translation will be made, and anyway, there are some questions I will try to answer. So, geopolitics. La géopolitique a longtemps été mal vue dans l'opinion. Après la dernière guerre mondiale, elle est devenue la mal-aimée des sciences sociales. On lui a aussi reproché d'être une science allemande, ce qui ne voulait pas dire grand-chose, sinon qu'elle doit une partie de son essor initial au principe de géographie politique énoncé par le géographe allemand Friedrich Ratzel, 1844-1904. Le terme de géopolitique, ayant été employé pour la première fois par le géographe suédois Rudolf Kjellberg en 1889. Dans son livre, Politische Biographie oder Geographie der Staaten des Verkehrs und des Krieges, 1897, Ratzel analysait l'interaction de l'État considéré comme un être vivant avec sa géographie et son espace. L'un de ses disciples fut le général bavarois Karl Haushofer, 1869-1946, fondateur de la Zeitschrift für Geopolitik. En pratiquant une évidente confusion entre l'espace au sens de la géopolitique et le Lebensraum, on a précisément mis en cause la proximité de Karl Haushofer et du national-socialisme. C'est bien à tort, et pas seulement parce que Haushofer n'a jamais été un idéologue de la démarche. Hitler avait beaucoup plus de sympathie pour les anglo-saxons que pour les slaves. Il fit la guerre à la Russie, puissance continentale, alors qu'il aurait préféré s'allier avec l'Angleterre, puissance maritime. S'il avait été acquis aux thèses de la géopolitique, il aurait fait exactement le contraire.
Geopolitics has long been frowned upon by public opinion. Following World War II, it became the most unpopular of the social sciences. It had been accused of being a German science, which didn't really mean much, except that it owes its initial impetus to the political geography principles enunciated by the German geographer Friedrich Ratzel. The term geopolitics being used for the first time by the Swedish geographer Rudolf Kjellin back in 1889, in his book Politische Geographie oder die Geographie der Staaten des Weges und des Krieges, back in 1897. Russell analyzed the interactions of the state, considered as a living body in terms of its geography and its space. One of his disciples was the Bavarian general Karl Haushofer, founder of the Zeitschrift für Geopolitik. It was only by an obvious confusion between space and the geopolitical sense and Lebensraum that a proximity between Karl Haushofer and National Socialism was brought into question. This was wrongly so, and not only because Haushofer never was an ideologue of the Third Reich, more importantly, Hitler had much more sympathy for the Anglo-Saxon than he had for the Slavs. He waged a war against Russia, a continental power, yet he would have preferred to ally with Great Britain, a sea power. Had he subscribed to the thesis of geopolitics, he would have done the exact opposite.
Mais c'est surtout la définition de son champ d'étude ou de son statut qui n'a jamais cessé de poser problème. La géopolitique étudie l'influence de la géographie sur la politique et sur l'histoire, c'est-à-dire les rapports entre l'espace et la puissance, politique, économique ou autre. Mais cette définition reste floue, ce qui explique que la réalité même de son objet ait pu être contestée. On l'a donc souvent décrite comme une discipline visant à légitimer rétrospectivement des événements historiques ou des décisions politiques.
Moreover, the definition of his discipline's field of study, or its status, has never ceased to be a problem. Geopolitics studies the influence of geography on politics and history. That is to say, the relationship between space and power, political, economic, or other. Yet, the definition remains fuzzy, which explains that the reality of both the concept and the relationship to its objective have been disputed. It has therefore been described as a discipline aiming to legitimize retrospectively historical events or political decisions.
Ces critiques ne vont toutefois pas au fond des choses. Que l'on puisse repérer dans l'histoire les constantes géographiques de l'action politique est en effet incontestable. Les spécialistes en ont donné d'innombrables exemples. La géopolitique reste donc une discipline d'une grande valeur et d'une grande importance. Il est même indispensable de s'y référer dans un monde en transition où toutes les cartes sont en train d'être redistribuées à l'échelle planétaire. La géopolitique relative le poids des seuls facteurs idéologiques, mouvants par définition, et rappelle l'existence de grandes constantes qui transcendent les régimes politiques comme les débats d'idées.
These criticisms do not, however, go to the bottom of things. That we can identify through history geographical constants of political action is, as a matter of fact, indisputable. Geopolitics remains thus a discipline of great value and great importance. It is even essential to refer to it in a word in translation, where all the cards are being redistributed worldwide. Geopolitics puts into perspective the weight of merely ideological factors unstable by definition, and recalls the existence of large constants that transcends political regimes as well as the intellectual debates.
De toutes les notions propres à la géopolitique, l'une des plus significatives est sans nul doute l'opposition dialectique de la mer et de la terre. L'histoire mondiale, disait Carl Schmitt, est l'histoire de la lutte des puissances maritimes contre les puissances continentales et des puissances continentales contre les puissances maritimes. C'était aussi l'opinion de l'amiral Castex et de bien d'autres géopoliticiens. Alfred Mackinder, par exemple, définit la puissance anglaise par la domination des océans et des mers. Il concevait la planète comme un ensemble composé d'un océan mondial, d'une île mondiale correspondant à l'ensemble eurasiatique ainsi qu'à l'Afrique, et d'îles périphériques, l'Amérique et l'Australie. Pour dominer le monde, il faut s'emparer de l'île mondiale et principalement de son cœur, le Heartland, véritable pivot géographique du monde, s'étendant de l'Europe centrale à la Sibérie occidentale et jusqu'en direction de la Méditerranée, du Proche-Orient et de l'Asie du Sud. L'un des premiers grands navigateurs anglais, Sir Walter Raleigh, disait déjà « Qui tient la mer, tient le commerce du monde. Qui tient le commerce, tient la richesse. Qui tient la richesse du monde, tient le monde lui-même. »
Of all the concepts specific to geopolitics, one of the most significant is undoubtedly the dialectical opposition between sea and land. World history, said Carl Schmitt, is the history of the fight of maritime powers against continental powers and the continental powers against maritime powers. It was also the Admiral Castex's opinion, as well as of many other geopoliticians. Alfred Mackinder, for example, defines the power of Great Britain by the domination of the oceans and seas. He perceives the planet as a whole, composed of global ocean and global islands, corresponding to the entire Eurasian space as well as Africa and peripheral islands, America and Australia. In order to dominate the world, we must seize the global island and primarily its heart, the heartland, the real world's geographical people stretching from Central Europe to Western Siberia and towards the Mediterranean, from Middle East and South Asia. One of the first English great navigators, Sir Walter Raleigh, used to say, "Whoever controls the sea controls the world trade. Whoever controls the world trade holds the treasures of the world in his possession, and in fact, the whole world."
Dans l'histoire de l'humanité, l'affrontement entre la terre et la mer correspond à la lutte séculaire entre la logique continentale européenne et la logique insulaire incarnée aujourd'hui par les États-Unis d'Amérique. Mais l'opposition entre terre et mer va bien au-delà des perspectives qu'ouvre la géopolitique. La Terre est un espace formé de territoires différenciés par des frontières. Sa logique se fonde sur des distinctions tranchées entre la guerre et la paix, les combattants et les non-combattants, l'action politique et le commerce. Elle est donc par excellence le lieu de la politique et de l'histoire. Comme le disait Adriano Cianca, l'existence politique a un caractère purement tellurique. La mer, au contraire, est une étendue uniforme, la négation des différences, des limites et des frontières. Elle est un espace d'indistinction, l'équivalent liquide du désert. N'ayant pas de centre, elle ne connaît que des flux et des reflux, et c'est par là qu'elle s'apparente à la globalisation postmoderne. Le monde actuel est en effet un monde liquide, comme le disait Kurt Baumann, qui tente à faire disparaître tout ce qui est terrestre, stable, solide, constant, durable, différencié. C'est un monde de flux véhiculés par des réseaux. Le commerce lui-même, comme la logique du capitalisme, est lui aussi fait de flux et de reflux.
In the history of mankind, the confrontation between land and sea is the age-old struggle between the European continental logic and the insular logic, embodied nowadays by the US. But the opposition between land and sea goes well beyond the perspective offered by geopolitics. The land is a space formed by territories differentiated by borders. Its logic is based on sharp distinctions between war and peace, combatants and non-combatants, political action and trade. It is therefore the place of politics and history par excellence. Political existence is of pure telluric nature, as says Adrian Shankar. The sea is an homogeneous area, the negation of differences, limits and borders. It is a space of indistinctness, the liquid equivalent of the desert. Being centerless, it only knows ebb and flow. This is how it is related to the postmodern globalization. The actual world is indeed a liquid world, to quote Zygmunt Bauman, which tends to eliminate everything that is earthly, stable, solid, consistent, sustainable, differentiated. It is a world of flux carried by networks. Trade itself, as well as the logic of it, as well as the logic of it, is also formed in the manner of ebb and flow.
la géopolitique a retrouvé toute sa légitimité avec les différents conflits qui ont émergé dans les années 1970. La plus grande partie de ces conflits ont été menés par les États-Unis. Marqués depuis leurs origines puritaines par la conviction d'être le nouveau peuple élu, les Américains ont voulu s'instaurer comme un modèle universel qui apporterait au monde entier les bienfaits de l'American Way of Life, c'est-à-dire un modèle de civilisation commerciale fondé sur le primat des valeurs d'échange et la logique du profit. Cette mission planétaire serait leur destinée manifeste, manifest destiny. La géopolitique est précisément la discipline qui permet d'expliquer les constantes de leur politique étrangère.
Geopolitics has regained its legitimacy with the various conflicts that have arisen since the 1970s. Most of these conflicts have been carried out by the US, marked from their Puritan origins by the conviction of being the new chosen people. The Americans have intended to establish themselves as a universal model, which would bring to the world the benefits of the American way of life. That is to say, a model of commercial civilization, based on the primacy of exchange value and the logic of profit. This planetary mission would be their manifest destiny. Geopolitics is precisely the discipline which helps to explain the constant of their foreign policy.
La désintégration du système soviétique, en même temps qu'elle a rendu possible la globalisation, a marqué la disparition d'un compétiteur redoutable pour la puissance américaine, qui a alors eu la tentation de façonner un monde unipolaire placé sous son hégémonie, ce que l'on a appelé le nouvel ordre mondial. Au lendemain de cette désintégration, les États-Unis se sont retrouvés comme un empire sans ombre, comme le disait Eric Hobsbawm. Confiant dans leur supériorité technologique, dans leur puissance militaire, dans les privilèges que leur confère le système du dollar, ils ont pensé que s'annonçait un siècle américain. Convaincus d'être désormais la seule superpuissance mondiale, ils ont prétendu jouer le rôle de gendarme du monde. Les néoconservateurs furent à la pointe de ce projet. C'est l'époque où Francis Fukuyama croyait pouvoir annoncer la fin de l'histoire, en l'occurrence le triomphe du capitalisme libéral et de la démocratie des droits de l'homme comme horizon indépassable de notre temps.
The disbanding of the Soviet Union, of the Soviet system has at the same time made globalization possible and marked the disappearance of a tremendous competitor for American power, which had the temptation to shape a unipolar world under its hegemony, what has been called the New World Order. In the aftermath of the Soviet disbanding, the US find themselves as an empire without shadow, to quote Eric Hobsbawm. Confident in their technological superiority and in their military power, in the benefits given by the dollar system, they have thought that an American century was about to be forthcoming. Convinced to be, from this point forward, the world's only superpower, they have pretended to play the role of the world police. The neoconservatives were at the forefront of this project. This was the time Francis Fukuyama thought he could announce the end of history, namely the triumph of liberal capitalism. And the democracy of human rights as the unsurpassable horizon of our time.
À la fin des années 1990, Arbatov, conseiller de Gorbatchev, avait déclaré aux Américains « Nous allons vous porter le coup le plus terrible, nous allons vous priver d'ennemis. » Parole significative. La disparition de l'Empire du Mal, Empire of Evil, soviétique, risquait en effet de supprimer toute légitimation idéologique de l'hégémonie américaine. Il fallait dès lors aux États-Unis trouver un ennemi de rechange dont la menace réelle ou supposée leur permettrait de s'instaurer comme les maîtres du nouvel ordre mondial. C'est l'islamisme radical qu'ils avaient pourtant constamment encouragé dans les décennies précédentes qui va jouer ce rôle de repoussoir. Mais en réalité, Leur objectif fondamental n'a pas changé. Il s'agit d'empêcher partout dans le monde l'émergence d'un compétiteur capable de rivaliser avec eux et surtout de contrôler le Heartland, l'île mondiale.
At the end of the 90s, Gorbachev advisor Gorbachev declared to the Americans, "We are dealing you with the worst blow. We are going to deprive you of your enemy." Significant words. The disappearance of the Soviet evil empire threatened to eradicate all ideological legitimization of American hegemony over her allies. This meant that, from then on, the Americans needed to find an alternative enemy, which provided threats, real or imaginary, that would allow them to establish themselves as the master of the New World Order. It is radical Islam, something they constantly encouraged in previous decades, that we played the role of a foil. But in reality, the fundamental objective remains unchanged. It is to prevent, anywhere in the world, the emergence of a rival capable of competing with them, and most importantly, to control the Heartland, the global island.
Dans son livre, The Grand Chess Board, paru en 1997, Zbigniew Brzezinski énumère sans détour les impératifs géostratégiques que les États-Unis doivent respecter pour maintenir leur hégémonie mondiale. Décrivant un projet de management global de la situation, il met en garde, je le cite, contre la création ou l'émergence d'une coalition eurasienne qui pourrait chercher à défier la suprématie américaine. En 2001, Henry Kissinger disait déjà: l'Allemagne doit maintenir une présence en Asie et son objectif géopolitique doit être d'empêcher la transformation de l'Asie en un bloc hostile. Brzezinski le rappelle à son tour, qui contrôle l'Eurasie, contrôle le monde.
In his book, The Grand Chessboard, published in 1997, Zbigniew Brzezinski enumerates explicitly the geostrategic imperatives that the US must meet to maintain their global hegemony, describing a project of global management of the world. He warns against the creation of the emergence of an Eurasian coalition that could seek to challenge America's supremacy. In 2001, Henry Kissinger was already saying, America must retain a presence in Asia, and its geopolitical objective must remain to prevent Asia's coalescence into unfriendly bloc. Brzezinski recalled in his turn, who controls Eurasia controls the world.
Contrôler l'Eurasie, cela signifie d'abord adopter une stratégie d'encerclement de la Russie et de la Chine. La stratégie d'encerclement de la Russie comprend l'installation de nouvelles bases militaires en Europe de l'Est, l'implantation de systèmes de défense antimissiles en Pologne, en Tchéquie et en Roumanie, le soutien à l'adhésion de l'Ukraine et de la Géorgie à l'OTAN, la poursuite d'une politique agressive visant à disloquer l'influence russe dans les régions névralgiques de la mer Noire, de la mer Caspienne et du Caucase. En matière d'approvisionnement énergétique, cette stratégie conduit à contrôler les oléoducs d'une Asie centrale transformée en protectorat américain, à encourager le développement à partir de la Caspienne d'oléoducs contournant la Russie pour déboucher vers la Turquie et à limiter le plus possible l'accès des tankers russes au détroit du Bosphore et des Dardanelles. C'est aussi dans ce cadre qu'il faut placer les révolutions colorées de Serbie en 2000, de Géorgie en 2003, d'Ukraine en 2004 et du Kyrgyzstan qui, loin de correspondre à des mouvements spontanés, furent organisés et soutenus de l'extérieur avec l'appui de la National Endowment for Democracy par avant de la CIA.
To control Eurasia means, first of all, adopting a strategy of encirclement of Russia and China. The encirclement of Russia strategy includes the installation of new military bases in Eastern Europe, the establishment of anti-missiles defense system in Poland, Czech Republic and Romania, supporting the accession of Ukraine and Georgia to NATO, and pursuing an aggressive policy aiming to dislocate Russia's influence in key regions around the Black Sea, the Caspian Sea, and the Caucasus. In terms of energy supply, this strategy leads to control of Central Asia's pipelines, Central Asia being transformed into an American protectorate, encouraging the development of pipelines in the Caspian to bypass Russia and to reach Turkey, as well as limiting as much as possible the access of Russian tankers to the Bosphorus and the Dardanelles Straits. It is within this context that we must put the Color Revolution in Serbia in 2000, Georgia in 2003, Ukraine in 2004, and Kyrgyzstan. Far from being spontaneous movements, these were organized and supported from the outside with the endorsement of the National Endowment for Democracy, a convenient front for the CIA.
La mise en place d'un arc de crise visant à déstabiliser l'espace d'influence traditionnel de la Russie dans les régions du Caucase, de l'Afghanistan et de l'Asie centrale ne se comprend que dans cette perspective. Sous couvert de poursuivre la lutte contre le terrorisme engagé en Afghanistan, les Américains ont installé des bases militaires dans les anciennes républiques soviétiques, notamment le Tadjikistan et le Kyrgyzstan. L'objectif se résume en trois mots: encercler, déstabiliser, balkaniser.
The establishment of an arc of crisis to destabilize Russia's traditional sphere of influence in the Caucasus, Afghanistan and Central Asia can only be understood in this context. Using the alleged war against terror, in Afghanistan, the US and her allies have set up military bases in the former Soviet Republic, including Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan. The objective can be summed up in three words: encircle, destabilize, balkanize.
Parallèlement, les Américains se sont efforcés d'élargir massivement l'OTAN en Europe orientale et balkanique, jusqu'aux frontières de la Russie, à l'intérieur même de l'ancienne Union soviétique. Dès le 11 septembre 2001, le président George W. Bush avait d'ailleurs pris position pour une grande OTAN, de la Baltique à la mer Noire, afin de s'ouvrir la voie de la Caspienne et de la mer Noire. Cela revenait à passer d'une structure relativement statique à un modèle expéditionnaire d'intervention néocoloniale tous azimuts, les centres de gravité de la géostratégie mondiale glissant dans le même temps vers le Moyen-Orient et l'Asie.
In parallel and simultaneously, the endeavor to massively expand NATO in Eastern Europe and in the Balkans as far as the Russian border, even within the former Soviet Union. As of September 11, 2001, President George W. Bush took a stand in favor of a large NATO from the Baltic Sea to the Black Sea to pave the way from the Caspian and the Black Sea. That is to go from a relatively static structure to an expeditionary model of neocolonial intervention in all directions, global geostrategic centers of gravity, sleeping those to the Middle East and Asia.
Le maintien de l'OTAN avait deux autres objectifs. Le premier est de continuer à dissuader l'Union européenne de bâtir une défense européenne commune et autonome. Les Américains ont en effet toujours considéré que la défense européenne sera amenée pour eux à former un pilier européen de l'OTAN. Le second objectif est l'affaiblissement des rapports de la Russie avec l'Europe de l'Ouest, l'Allemagne étant particulièrement visée compte tenu de l'ampleur de ses échanges technologiques, énergétiques, économiques et commerciaux avec le Kremlin. Dans ce projet, l'Union européenne devient une simple tête de pont américaine en Eurasie.
Maintaining NATO has two other goals. The first one is to continue to dissuade the EU to build up a common and autonomous European defense force. Americans have always considered that European defense meant them, quote, the setup of NATO's European pillar or arm. The second goal is to weaken the relations between Russia and Western Europe. Germany is particularly targeted, given the extent of its technological, energy and economical exchange within Russia. In this project, the EU becomes a simple American bridgehead in Eurasia.
Au Proche-Orient, où ils sont confrontés à des défis majeurs en raison de l'instabilité de la région, de l'échec de leurs interventions militaires dans le Golfe et de l'isolement croissant de leur indéfectible allié israélien, les États-Unis développent une stratégie offensive pour contrer la montée en puissance de l'Iran qui les inquiète en raison de ses richesses énergétiques, de ses relations privilégiées avec la Chine et la Russie, de son influence grandissante en Irak et dans les pays du Golfe où se trouve une importante minorité chiite. Enfin, ils opèrent actuellement un retour spectaculaire en Afrique noire, à la fois pour contrebalancer l'influence de la Chine et pour tenir compte de l'importance grandissante du continent africain dans les approvisionnements énergétiques mondiaux.
In Middle East, where they're facing serious challenges due to the instability of the region, the failure of their military interventions, and the growing isolation of their unswerving Israeli ally, the US are developing an aggressive strategy to counter the rise of Iran, which worries them because of its energy resources, its privileged relationship with China and Russia, and its increasing influence in Iraq and in the Gulf countries, where there are significant Shiite minorities. Finally, they are currently engaged in a spectacular return to Africa for two reasons: to counterbalance China's influence and to take into account the growing importance of Africa in terms of global energy supplies.
Pour développer cette politique agressive, les États-Unis ne manquent pas de moyens technologiques et financiers. Malgré leurs grandes difficultés financières et leurs déficits phénoménaux, leur budget militaire, qui est en augmentation constante, avoisine aujourd'hui les 700 milliards de dollars, montant colossal équivalent à plus de 40% du total de tous les budgets militaires du monde réunis.
To develop this aggressive policy, the US are not short of technological and financial means. Despite their financial difficulties and their exceptional deficits, their military budget, which is constantly increasing, is now close to 700 billion. A colossal amount, equivalent to more than 40% of all military budgets combined in the world.
La question se pose néanmoins de savoir si les États-Unis n'ont pas atteint les limites de leur capacité d'expansion impériale. Leurs difficultés intérieures s'aggravent. Le système du dollar dont ils ont tiré tant de profits vacille sur ses bases. La crise financière mondiale qui s'est ouverte chez eux en 2008 les a frappés de plein fouet. Leur déficit commercial et leur endettement public atteignent des records absolus. En Russie, Vladimir Poutine, qui a clairement perçu leurs intentions, a nettement rompu avec l'ère catastrophique de Boris Yeltsin, qui avait consacré la toute-puissance des oligarques.
However, the question arises whether the United States have not reached the limits of their imperial expansion capacity. Their domestic issues worsen. The dollar system, which they capitalize on, teeters on the brink. The global financial crisis that started there back in 2008 hit them with full force. Their trade gap and the public debt have reached an all-time high. In Russia, meanwhile, Vladimir Putin, who clearly perceived their intentions, clearly brought from the catastrophic era under Boris Yeltsin, who had sanctified the omnipotence of the oligarchs.
Les plus récents événements liés à la guerre civile en Syrie ont à nouveau mis en lumière l'importance de la géopolitique. L'extrême habileté dont ont fait preuve Vladimir Poutine et son ministre des Affaires étrangères Sergei Lavrov face à l'indécision de Barack Obama et à la naïveté de François Hollande a été révélatrice. Avec son intervention dans l'affaire syrienne, la Russie a retrouvé son rôle de grande puissance mondiale et montré qu'elle n'est plus partie négligeable dans les affaires internationales, mais qu'il faudra au contraire compter avec elle à l'avenir.
The most recent events related to the civil war in Syria have, again highlighted the importance of geopolitics. The extreme acumen of Vladimir Putin and his foreign minister, Sergei Lavrov, against Barack Obama's indecisiveness and François Hollande's naivety has been symptomatic. With its intervention in the Syrian affair, Russia has regained its role of a major world power, and those showed that Russia is not a negligible party in international affairs, but that it will have to be reckoned within the future.
Le moment unipolaire n'a donc pas duré 10 ans. Les Américains, qui ne représentent plus que 5% de la population mondiale, ont surestimé leurs forces. L'enlisement de leurs troupes en Irak et en Afghanistan, leurs difficultés intérieures, leurs déficits colossaux, l'instabilité du pouvoir, la crise financière mondiale leur imposent des limites. Il apparaît très vite qu'ils ne régneront pas sur le monde sans partage. L'histoire dont Fukuyama a annoncé la fin a déjà fait retour.
The unipolar moment has therefore not lasted for 10 years. The Americans, who now only represent 5% of the world population, have overestimated their strength. The engulfing of their troops in Iraq and Afghanistan, their domestic issues, their abyssal deficits, the instability of the dollar system, and the world's financial crisis have imposed limits on them. It quickly becomes apparent that they will not rule the world unchallenged. The history which Fukuyama announced the end has already returned.
Un monde multipolaire s'esquisse derrière la poussée fulgurante de la Chine, suivie de l'Inde, du Brésil, voire de l'Iran. Les économies émergentes connaissent une croissance spectaculaire. Leur part dans le produit intérieur brut mondial, en parité de pouvoir d'achat, est passée de 36% en 1980 à 45% en 2008. Elle devrait atteindre 51% en 2014.
A multipolar world is emerging on the back of China's rapid surge, followed by India, Brazil, and even Iran. Emerging economies are growing dramatically. Their share in the world's gross domestic product in purchasing power parity has gone from 36% in the 1980 to 45% in 2008 and should reach 51% in 2014.
La stratégie eurasiatique des États-Unis a suscité en réaction un rapprochement significatif entre la Russie et la Chine, qui s'est concrétisé notamment au sein de l'Organisation de coopération de Shanghai, créée le 15 juin 2001, qui comprend également quatre pays d'Asie centrale, le Kazakhstan, le Kirghizistan, le Tadjikistan et l'Ouzbékistan, l'Iran, la Mongolie, l'Inde et l'Afghanistan, et bénéficiant du statut d'observateur.
The US Eurasian strategy has led as a reaction to a significant rapprochement between Russia and China, which has materialized with the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, founded in June 2001, which also includes four Central Asia countries, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and Uzbekistan, while Mongolia, India, and Afghanistan participate as observers.
On sait qu'au cours de ces dernières années, l'Iran s'est fortement rapproché de la Chine et de la Russie. Cette alliance pragmatique se matérialise aujourd'hui par des appuis géopolitiques réciproques qui ont amené certains observateurs à envisager la possibilité de voir se former dans les années qui viennent une sorte de nouvel empire mongol. Entre 1206 et 1294, l'empire turco-mongol de Genghis Khan s'était étendu sur l'ensemble de l'Asie centrale avant de se morceler en quatre blocs. Aujourd'hui, l'Organisation de coopération de Shanghai, dont le principal objectif est de contrer l'influence américaine en Asie centrale, associe à nouveau la Russie, la Chine et l'Iran, trois pays différents, et formant une véritable communauté d'intérêts et qui représente plus d'1,5 milliard d'habitants. La grande différence avec l'ancien empire mongol est évidemment qu'aujourd'hui l'Iran considère la Turquie comme une puissance régionale rivale.
We know that in recent years, Iran has strengthened its relationship with China and Russia. This pragmatic alliance materializes today, utilizing mutual geopolitical support that have led some observers to consider the possibility to witness in the coming years the rise of a kind of new Mongol Empire. Between 206 and 294, Genghis Khan's Turkish Mongol Empire had spread throughout Central Asia before breaking up into four blocks. Today, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, whose main goal is to counter US influence in Central Asia, is associated again with Russia, China, and Iran, three different countries, yet forming a real community of interest, which represents 1.5 billion people. The big difference with the former Mongol Empire, however, is that today, Iran sees Turkey as a regional rival power.
Depuis la fin du système soviétique, nous sommes donc entrés dans un interrègne, un Zwischenzeit. L'ancien nomos de la Terre a disparu, mais les contours d'un nouveau nomos se laissent seulement deviner. Le grand conflit mondial actuel est celui qui oppose la puissance continentale eurasiatique à la thalassocratie américaine. La question principale qui se pose et de savoir si nous allons vers un monde unipolaire, un universo, ou vers un monde multipolaire, un pluriverso.
Since the end of the Soviet system, we have entered in an interregnum, a Zwischenzeit. The former nomos of the Earth is gone, but the contours of a new nomos can be speculated upon. The actual big world conflict is the one that opposes the Eurasian continental power to the American thalassocracy. The main question is whether we are going towards a unipolar world, a universum, or towards a multipolar world, a pluriversum.
Le problème est que les Européens n'en sont que très rarement conscients. Les Américains ont beaucoup de défauts, mais il y a quelque chose au moins qu'on ne peut leur dénier. C'est d'être conscient des enjeux globaux et de tenter de penser le monde à venir. En Russie et en Chine aussi, on pense le monde à venir. Les Européens, eux, ne pensent rien. Ils ne se soucient que du moment présent. Ils vivent sous l'horizon de la fatalité, avec les institutions qui les condamnent à l'impuissance et à la paralysie. L'Europe vit comme un état d'apesanteur, confrontée à une crise morale sans précédent, au défi de l'immigration et du vieillissement démographique, des délocalisations et de la compétition mondiale. Elle ne sait visiblement plus comment défendre ses chances dans un monde globalisé. Porteuse d'une identité qu'elle ne sait plus définir, hantée par le secret désir de se retirer de l'histoire au risque de devenir un objet de l'histoire des autres, s'imaginant que les hommes sont partout les mêmes, l'Europe est aujourd'hui pauvre en monde, comme le disait Heidegger. Elle paraît épuisée, en proie à une lassitude qui la conduit à ne vouloir plus rien. Géopolitique de l'impuissance, montée de l'insignifiance, les billets libellés en euros en sont comme le reflet. Ils ne représentent rien, ils ne représentent que du vide.
The problem is that Europeans are rarely aware of this. Americans may have many faults, but there is something we cannot deny them. They are aware of the global stakes and to try to think the world to come. In Russia and China too, they think the world to come. Europeans, they don't think. They only care about the present moment. They live under the horizon of fate, with institutions that condemn them to powerlessness and paralysis. Europe lives in a state of weightlessness, facing an unprecedented moral crisis. The problem of immigration, an aging population, economic offshoring and global competition. It appears Europe cannot defend its place in a globalized world, bearing an identity that she cannot anymore define, haunted by the secret desire to withdraw herself from history, thus running the risk of becoming the object of others' history. Thinking men are everywhere of the same disposition, Europe is now poor in words, to quote Heidegger. She seems exhausted, beset by lassitude that leads to not wanting anything. Geopolitics of powerlessness, rise of insignificance, Euro banknotes are like its reflection. They only represent emptiness.
Dans le passé, la géopolitique exerçait ses contraintes principalement au niveau des États, qui de nos jours, au moins dans l'hémisphère occidental, semblent être entrés dans une crise irréversible. Aujourd'hui, elle révèle des logiques continentales que les agissements désordonnés des États ont longtemps masqués et qui sont désormais plus fondamentales que jamais. Elle aide à raisonner en termes non plus seulement de pays, mais aussi de continents, comme disait Jordis von Blumhausen. La mer contre la terre, aujourd'hui, c'est les États-Unis d'Amérique contre le reste du monde, the rest of the world, et d'abord contre le bloc continental eurasiatique et européen. L'ensemble germano-russe reste au cœur du centre mondial. En ce sens, l'effondrement du système soviétique a clarifié les choses. Il n'y a désormais plus que deux positions possibles. Soit l'on est du côté de la puissance maritime américaine, soit l'on est du côté de la puissance continentale eurasiatique. C'est cette dernière position qui est la mienne.
In the past, geopolitics deployed its constraints mainly at state level. The same states that seem to have entered an irreversible crisis, at least in the Western Hemisphere. Now, it depends on the logic of continents, which has long been hidden behind the disorderly conduct of the state, but that is now more fundamental than ever. Geopolitics helped to think in terms not only of countries, but also of continents, to quote Joris von Lausen. The sea against the land, now it is the US against the rest of the world, and first against the Eurasian and European continental bloc. In this sense, the collapse of the Soviet system has clarified things. There are now only two possible positions, either being on the side of the American sea power, or being on the side of the Eurasian continental power. I'm with the latter.
That's all, thanks.
Right, thank you for that. Same regime as last time. Questions directed through me, please. On Nick.
Okay. Right, I asked this question by starting off with a quote from somebody called Dmitry Mamulitsky in 1948, who was in the United Nations Security Council. He said, "Britain is the rock upon which the waves of revolution have so far dashed themselves in vain. Britain and her people must be destroyed before we can reach our ultimate objectives." Now the reason I use that quote is because I wanted to refer to the US and this collapse that everybody's talking about today. Obviously the US has stretched itself beyond its means because of its internal equality and social justice programs, and externally its military programs. It's obviously apparent to a lot of people in positions of power in the United States that the expenditures seem high, and this could result in collapse. It's easy to see that, and obviously countermeasures could be taken, but they're not. So could it be that this is the intentional popping of the US?
Sorry, can you just repeat the last part of the question?
Popping.
Is the collapse organic or predestined? Time?
Okay, the US collapse.
Well, why has somebody could easily spot that what the US is doing is heading on the cliff.
Right.
And it could easily be changed.
Okay.
But is it intentional?
You want to know if it's planned?
Yeah.
Right.
Much to say about that point. Of course, there are Zionist lobbies everywhere in every major country, but to explain everything through the influence, which is real, of these lobbies is clearly for me completely conspirationist. If you engage yourself following these lines, you miss the whole pictures. You see some trees, but not the whole forest. Just a word, just two words to say that if you make your questions shorter, it will be much easier for you to answer.
Okay, gentleman in the back in the brown jacket.
Yes, you depicted in your speech the threat to America or to the American imperial system as Russia. Surely China is the bigger threat. Russia has a falling population. China's population is enormous. It controls most of the world's treasury bonds, the American treasury bonds. Its naval power is expanding. Its military power is expanding. It produces most of the world's manufacturers. It's gobbling up raw materials globally. Is not China, on a longer term basis, a far bigger threat than Russia is to America?
Well, about the relationship between America and China, there's many speculations. China had extraordinary growth since some years. But is this growth able to stay? I'm not sure about that. Chinese people are also, Chinese government has also many problems. You cannot take the actual growth of China and say it will be the same or maybe still higher in the coming years. We have to see that. It is clear that today China has the power to make the United States quite bankrupt. But is it their interest? This is not clear either. They sell many things in America. America is a very big market for China. If they ruin the Americans, so they don't sell anything more. So it's complicated. But this is a real problem, of course. We have to look for the next years how the economic relationship between America and China will evolve.
What do you see as the driving force between the process, behind the process of turning Europe and America into multiracial societies?
Can you repeat that question?
What is the driving force between moving towards multiracial societies?
Well, your question is about immigration and where is the driving force?
Yes.
Very simple for me. Driving force is capitalism, capitalist system, which means suppression of all borders. Free market means free circulation. That was already said by Adam Smith and the others. You have to suppress everything which could be an obstacle to exchange. And when you give priority to exchange value, to use value, so you accelerate globalization and so on. When you live in a world where economical values have taken the place of any kind of values, you push the people to leave their former, the place where they are born to try to go elsewhere. So this is what we see today. It's not a conspiracy, even if some people would think that it would be very nice if the whole third world would come to live in Europe and so on. But it's a systemic effect, consequence of the logic of profit, of the primacy given to economic and commercial values, and finally of the capitalist system.
Even when there's no jobs going around, we're still, the immigration imperative is still there, the cheap labour, the capitalists, when there's failing employment, that doesn't seem to connect to me.
Yeah, Yes, of course. Yeah. Of course, the capitalist system needs people without jobs because it's very useful to put the pressure of the wage of the other workers. I remember that the first, you could say, corporate association in France in the 19th century, they said we must open the borders because when we have a cheap force of labor which comes from foreign countries, we can push
wages
to put you down for the wages of the people. So this is very classical. It's what pushed me to, I wrote an article but with the title of the immigration as the army, the reserve army of the capital. It is a reserve army.
Andrew Neither.
No, through me, please. Gentleman in the blue shirt.
Yeah. If, well, 26 years ago, Paul Kennedy wrote his classic book, The Rise and Fall of the Great Powers, where, of course, he predicted American decline, which he called the declines. One is, within 2 years later, of course, it was the Soviet Union which collapsed, not America. You know, I'm just thinking that 26 years on, what do you think of The Rise and Fall of Great Powers by Paul Kennedy? Because it is, of course, a very impressive book.
I know the book written by Kennedy, of course, with the so-called declinist schools in the US. Well, what is interesting with the fall of the Soviet Union is that it was not foreseen by many people. I remember that Mitterrand, French, and many other politicians in Western countries strongly believed that the Soviet Union was still in great danger, was still there for many, many years. So everything came like in a fairy tale. The dismantling of the wall, Berlin, and the fall of the system. So this is a great lesson. It's a great lesson about history. Human history is always open. Is always open. And it is largely unforeseeable. So when we try to imagine the future, we usually take the current present trends and we extrapolate in the future. But sometimes there is a break, sometimes many things which it was impossible to foresee happen. If you look back, on the 20 or 25 years last years, you see that all the major events were not foreseen. So you know there is people who have the profession of futurologists, but they don't say much. They draw some scenarios, but they are unable to say which scenario is more probable to. So that is maybe the reason we can tie it. And by extrapolation, we can say that it is the same as the United States. It could break very quickly. The American system could be dismantled as quickly as the Soviet system. So, wait and see.
Gentleman in the red suit.
Most of us, I think, would recognize your description of geopolitics fairly simply, but you describe capitalism as driving these things, but we most of us, I think, well, certainly many of us would think that capitalism is run by an elite of people. It's a pyramidal system, and at the top there's an elite running that system. They got rid of laws that protected their own system from collapse. many of us have read people at the Frankfurt School, who were a think tank for this elite, as to how to impose their will on the dumb masses. And it looks like to many of us as if the strategies described by the Frankfurt School have been carried out on us and have been very successful in dividing and ruling on behalf of this elite. So the fact that there's no conspiracy, no conspiracies, I mean, personally, I really reject that. I think there is a conspiracy at the top. I think that the conspiracies behind capitalism drive everything. Do you really see no conspiracies at all?
Is not, you cannot really compare the capitalist system just to repair me. It's more a flux. It's a system of nets. I don't believe in the conspiracy system. Because if you change all the people, all the living beings who are involved and profit, system, the system still continues. You have a systemic effect. It's like scientific research. You can change all the people, the laboratories continue. There is an essence of capitalism, which was, I think, not so badly seen by Karl Marx. This is the tendency to reification. So to transform the people in things. The capitalist system is a process of illimitation. There is no end to this quest. Always more markets, more profits, more exchange, more money. It's without any end. This is the real essence of capitalism. What is very strange for me is to see that maybe a bit in England, but mainly in the United States, so many so-called conservative people are completely in favor of the capitalist system. That is, that they want to fight for an economical system which destroys methodically everything which they want to conserve. This is very strange for me. But maybe I don't understand something because I'm not intelligent enough, because the very word conservative is strange for me, because I've never understood what these people want to conserve. Is there really anything to conserve in the present world of today? I don't think so I'm not really conservative.
Can I tell you about this meeting? About this meeting, which really shocked me. I noticed that the gentleman organizing it had numerous phones. We couldn't find out where the meeting was. You know, there's all this clandestine thing going on, and this tells me that that people are realistically paranoid about organizing anything which even criticizes the system. Therefore, I say there's a machine that is extremely conspiratorial, working against anything that might come.
Do you want to reply to this? Or is it just a statement?
sure, because I did not organize this. The logistics of organization. I was just invited to express my opinion. I gave it to you.
Yes.
You like it or you don't like it, that's fine. So,
just providing a bit of evidence.
Well, like I said, the logistics of organisation aren't something the speakers have anything to do with. But it's best to be safe than sorry. Today's social media. So the fact we're all here, the meeting's gone ahead, we consider that a success. Whether we've been over cautious, it doesn't matter. You know, the goal's been attained. Last question. Sorry, we'll have two more questions. And I think it's going to It's not going to stop. Gentlemen at the back, please.
Does the recent success of the Fundus in our advance provide hope for the future? Does the recent successes of the Fundus in our provide hope for the future?
I don't know. What I say is that it's interesting to see in different countries the success of the so-called populist parties. But these populist parties have very different positions on some key topics. You quote, you said the Front National, which in economical about economical topics has very different views of many of the other populist countries. Front National is very much against liberalism, but I must stress here once again that the word, the very word, liberal or liberalism has quite a different meaning in European, in the continental Europe and in England or America. When we in continental Europe speak about liberalism, this means individualism, market ideology, free exchange, and so on. If you speak to a French people and ask them to give the name of a very known liberal in Britain, you would say Margaret Thatcher, but in England this could seem very strange, of course, but that's a fact. For historical reasons, the word liberal has quite different meaning. So when I say that the National Front in France is against liberalism, that means that it is against the free exchange ideology, in methodological individualism, and that kind of thing. So, is it a hope? I don't know, because I don't know what they would be able to do. It's interesting to see that people who are out of the usual frame are rising. That's interesting to see for an observer, but I cannot go beyond.
Professor, last question.
Yes, this is a big one. You said that the collapse of the Soviet Union took everyone by surprise. But that is not so. It was predicted several years before it happened by Imam Khomeini in his famous letter to Gorbachev, in which he said that soon communism will only be found amongst museums of political history. Now, that letter was delivered to Gorbachev by the Imam's special envoy, who had instructions that it was to be opened in his presence. And he told me that when Gorbachev read it, his face went white, because Gorbachev is an atheist, and he wondered how this man of God could know things that were not known outside the walls of the Kremlin, because he had at that moment on his desk secret reports showing that within a few years the whole thing would just smash up.
You're right. I remember.
Okay.
I remember that I'm coming in.
Yeah. But no one, not even the CIA, with all their money committed, the MI5, the only one who got it was Imam Khomeini.
He told that, but that does not contradict the fact that everywhere in the world, most of the people believe the contrary. so I mean that if I'm cooking, you must be invited anymore. But I would not venture myself to say if he had some revelations about future history. When you say that, if I say that this man I see in the street will die tomorrow, probably it will not, but maybe he will. So when you predict something, just by chance, it's possible that it happens. So I'm not in a good position to say if Imam Khomeini had a revelation of if he just expressed his secret wish.
Okay, so we'll reconvene about 4 o'clock, if that's okay, and cut our last speaker.